Good afternoon, everybody. As explained, I will describe you my point of view on perspective of photovoltaics on the power exchanges. The schedule of my presentation is the following. First of all, I will give you a short overview of the electrical system. Second, I will focus on electricity generators, and more precisely, on some of their characteristics that can be valorized on, as products on different markets. Third, I will explain on a small example how these products are used to balance the system. At last, I will describe the opportunity of PV plants on these markets. Please note that in this presentation, I plan to spend much more time to describe the balancing mechanisms and associated products than to describe the functioning of markets. So, the electrical system consists of the physical infrastructure on one end and of an electricity market on the other. The physical grid dispatches the flow of electricity. It consists of electricity generator and electricity transport systems, which are usually subdivided into systems for transmission over long distances and systems for distribution to residential and industrial consumers. The electricity market dispatches the flow of money associated with the sale of electricity. In this market, electricity suppliers buy electricity from generators and from other suppliers and sell it to consumers. Consumers use electricity and pay suppliers via their bills. Transmission system operators, or TSO, are paid for the long-distance transport of electricity and for ensuring the system stability. Distribution network operator, or DSO, are paid for delivering electricity to consumers. Market operators provide a service whereby the offer to sell electricity are matched with bids to buy electricity. At last, regulators set rules and oversee the functioning of the market. The regulators of the member states of the European Union implement an energy policy built on three core objectives. First, competitiveness, to improve the efficiency of the European energy grid by creating a truly competitive internal energy market. Sustainability, to actively combat climate changes by promoting renewable energy sources, and energy efficiency. Security of supply, to better coordinate the European supply and demand for energy within an international context. One important security property of the electrical system is that the electricity supply must be equal to the electricity demand at all times, otherwise the system risks to shut down. But how the electrical system is organized to avoid such a breakdown? First of all, the market is by definition an environment designed to help buyers and sellers to interact and to agree on transactions. These interactions progressively lead to an equilibrium in which the price clears the market, that is, the supply is equal to the demand. But in practice, neither party can meet its contractual obligations with perfect accuracy. In fact, the actual demand of a group of consumers of the actual production of a group of power plants, especially for renewable ones, is never exactly equal to the value forecasted. Second, unpredictable problems often prevent generating units from delivering the contracted amount of energy. A sudden mechanical or electrical failure may force a unit to shut down or to reduce its output. These error and unpredictable events introduce gaps between load and generation. A balancing market has been set up to bridge this gap quickly and precisely. In other words, its role is to finally adjust the production of flexible generators and the demand of willing consumers. It should also be able to respond to major disruptions caused by the sudden and unforeseen disconnection of large generation units or of transmission lines or transformers. In France, the French TSO, named RTE, is the responsible of the balance of the electrical network and is also in charge of the balancing market. All the actions that RTE takes have a cost, called imbalance costs. These costs are dispatched between some actors of the electric market, called balance responsible parties, proportionally to the imbalance that they caused on the electrical system. It's important to note that in terms of volume, the energy used to restore the balance between load and generation represents approximately only 2% of the total electrical energy exchange in France. As explained, the energy market and balancing market are two different markets which are also separated in time in order to avoid counterproductive actions. To detail, let's consider a delivery period which starts at an hour H and which terminates at H plus 1. In the following, the planning phase is the period before H minus 1. The execution phase is the period between H minus 1 and H plus 1. And the settlement phase is the period between after H plus 1. During the planning phase, the suppliers, consumers and producers exchange electricity at different time horizons, each of them being associated with a market called intraday, day ahead or forward. In parallel, the TSO purchases to producers and in some extent to consumers some products which will be described later needed to balance the network. At H minus 1, the market player cannot modify their position and, in particular, producers are not allowed to modify their production plan. During the execution phase, the electricity flows in the network according to the agreements between market parties and the TSO acts on production and consumption to restore the balance between load and production. After H plus 1, the TSO calculates the imbalance cost. It also calculates the imbalance whose each BRPs are responsible and builds them in proportion of their imbalance. Let's now describe several properties of generator which are associated with products valorized on the different markets. First of all, an electricity generator produces electricity that may be sold on the electric energy market. Second, generators use different types of fuels. Some of them are renewable, such as PV wind or biomass, and some of them are not, such as gas, coal, nuclear, and oil. Generators which are fed by renewable fuels may emit guarantees of origin that can be valorized on markets, but will not discuss this point further in the presentation. Third, some kinds of generator, such as PV, wind, or nuclear, release few carbon dioxide, and some of them emit a lot of such a gas. The low carbon property is indirectly valorized in proportion to the price of the carbon dioxide. As for guarantees of origin, we'll not discuss this point further in the presentation. The generation capacity of the generator is generally considered as the maximum power that it can produce. But we may distinguish firm capacity generators that can be switched off and on demand, and variable capacity generators that are dependent on factors like wind or sunshine, and that are therefore only able to generate some certain amount of power at certain times. The French regulators have defined quantitatively the capacity after he enacts that each supplier is required to obtain sufficient capacity guarantees to cover the consumption of all of their customers during periods of peak national demand. Shortly, the capacity, also called certified capacity level, is calculated as the mean of the production of the generator during peak consumption periods, multiplied by a factor which depends on the type of generator. For solar, this factor is 25%. Besides, the obtained value has to be comprised for solar plant between 0 and 10% of the maximum power. The owner of the generator may emit capacity certificates which may be valorized on the capacity market. The last characteristic of the power plant is called flexibility. It is its capacity to change its generation pattern in response to an external order. Flexibility is very difficult to define precisely, but in the following, I will describe you the different parameters that are generally used to quantify this concept. To this aim, let's consider the following picture of a production curve of a generator. The parameter, in bold italics, characterizes its flexibility. It is its capability to increase or respectively decrease from a given functioning point, its power production up to upward megawatt, respectively down to downward megawatt, during at most X minutes if a command order is sent Y minute in advance. X is also called hold time, and Y is also called full activation time. The flexibility can be understood as a set of these four parameters. Some other parameters, such as ramping or starting cost, may also be considered. Nowadays, the valorization of the flexibility essentially depends on the FAT. If the FAT is greater than approximately 1 hour, the flexibility may be implicitly valorized in the energy market when the supplier defines the production plan of his generators, also called self-dispatch process. If the FAT is smaller than 1 hour, the flexibility may be explicitly valorized in the balancing market. I will not go further in the details, but there are different kinds of balancing product, also called frequency containment reserve, automatic frequency restoration reserve, manual frequency restoration reserve, or even recovery reserves. All these products differ from the value of the different parameters which characterize the flexibility. A supplier or a producer which sells either balancing capacity or balancing energy to the system operator is a balancing service provider. I will now distinguish these two kinds of products. Balancing energy means the energy used by the TSO to perform balancing and provided by the balancing service provider. In the figure, the TSO sends two orders to the BSP, one for increasing its production by 10 megawatt during 4 and 5 o'clock. One speaks of upward balancing energy, and one order for decreasing its production of 15 megawatt during between 5 and 6 o'clock. One speaks of downwarding balancing energy. Following these two orders, the producer will be paid for 10 megawatt hour by the TSO and will have to purchase 15 megawatt hour to the TSO. The maximum variation of power production to an order coming from the TSO is the balancing capacity. More precisely, the balancing capacity means a volume of capacity that a BSP has agreed to hold to the TSO for the duration of the contract. The balancing service provider has also agreed to submit bids for the corresponding volume of balancing energy to the transmission system operator. For example, in the future, the BSP has held 20 megawatt of upward capacity and has proposed a price of 50 euro per megawatt hour for the upward balancing energy. He has also held 50 megawatt of downward capacity and has proposed a price of 30 euro per megawatt hour for the downward balancing energy. Now I will explain how the system is balanced thanks to these products, and I will in particular explain what is the link between the energy and balancing market on a small example. So let's consider a very simple network with only two suppliers and one TSO. S1 is a supplier who owns two generators. G1 is a biomass plant, and G2 is a solar plant, and who supplies consumers. S1 is a balanced responsible party, that is, S1 assumes the financial responsibility for the imbalances he may incur at each delivery time. S1 is a balancing service provider too. S2 is a supplier who owns generator and who supplies consumer, and we consider that S2 is also a BRP. So generator and consumer are connected through the public grid. I'll focus my explanation on a given delivery time, for example, today at 4 o'clock. During the planning phase, S1 search to provide his customer with energy. More precisely, from several months in advance to 3 o'clock today, S1, as a supplier, estimates the sum of the power consumption of his customer at the delivery time, as it has been explained by Alberto. And S1, as generator owner, estimates the energy which may be produced by his generators. Let's call forecasted energy imbalance the difference between the forecasted consumption and the forecasted production. Then, S1, as BRP, purchases or sells energy from or to another supplier or to another utility owner to set energy imbalance as close as possible to zero. S2 performs exactly the same during the planning phase. During this phase, also, the TSO searches to provide himself with energy and balancing capacity. From several months in advance to 3 o'clock, the TSO estimates the need of balancing capacity for the whole network. He also purchases this amount of capacity to BSP. In the figure, the TSO buys balancing capacity and receives bids for the balancing energy from S1, which acts as BSP. As for the energy planning process, the difference between sales and purchases of balancing capacity has to be reduced as close as possible to zero. And the TSO performs the same for the balancing energy, but in this case, it's only option. Now, at the end of the planning phase, that is at 3 o'clock in the afternoon, we may obtain such position for the delivery period between 4 and 5 o'clock. The supplier S1 plans to provide 130 megawatt-hour to his consumers. 100 megawatt-hour come from its biomass plant, and 30 megawatt-hour come from its solar plant. As the biomass is not at its maximum power, he has proposed 20 megawatt of upward capacity to the TSO. He also provides 20 megawatt of downward capacity to the TSO from its biomass plant and 10 megawatt from its solar plant. The second supplier plans to produce 200 megawatt-hour and to sell these 200 megawatt-hours to its consumers. At 3 o'clock, the supplier can no more buy or sell energy between each other, and the execution phase begins. Let's consider that S2 encounters at the beginning of this execution phase an issue with one of his plant, and that this plant produces 10 megawatt-hour less than it was forecasted. In that case, S2 is imbalanced and the network is also imbalanced. As it lacks 10 megawatt-hour in the network, it's said to be short. In that case, the system operator detects this imbalance. To fix the issue, the system operator asks S1 to produce 10 megawatt of additional power during 1 hour. This is possible because S1 has proposed 20 megawatt of upward balancing capacity. According to his commitment, S1 produces 10 megawatt-hour with his biomass plant, and there is no more imbalance in the entire network. This 10 megawatt-hour of power flow from the supplier S1 to the supplier S2. At the settlement phase, the TSO first sums up all the costs, also called imbalance costs, associated with the balancing processes, in particular the capacity cost and its own functioning costs. Then, the TSO pays S1 for the upward and downward capacity and for the 10 megawatt-hour of upward balancing energy at X euro per megawatt hour. It is important to note that the price of this upward balancing energy is, in general, greater than the day-ahead market price. Then, the TSO charges S2 for this energy, augmented with a fraction, A, of the balancing costs. Let's consider a complementary case where S2's consumers consume 10 megawatt-hour less than forecasted. In that case, S2 and the network are imbalanced. In this case, there are 10 megawatt-hour in excess in the network, which is thus is said to be long. In such a case, the system operator detects this imbalance, and to fix this issue, the system operator asks S1 to produce 10 megawatt less during 1 hour. This is possible because S1 has sold 30 megawatt of downward balancing capacity. According to his commitment, S1 produces 10 megawatt-hour less than less with his solar plant, and there is no more imbalance in the entire network. In that case, the 10 megawatt-hour of power flows from the supplier S2 to the supplier S1. At the settlement phase, the TSO pays S1 for the upward and downward capacity. The TSO charges S1 for the 10 megawatt-hour of downward energy at Y euro per megawatt-hour. Here, it's also important to note that the price of the downward balancing energy is in general smaller than the day-ahead market price. Then, the TSO pays S2 for this energy decreased by the cost of the balancing process. The impacts of revenues of producer of all these processes is summarized in the two following slides. So let's consider only 1 hour, and then let's consider 3 cases. The first case is the case when the producer only sells its energy to the supplier. In this case, its revenue naturally only comes from the sale of its energy. In the second case, the producer sells, in addition, downward capacity to the TSO. In that case, revenues come from the energy sold to the supplier and from the downward balancing capacity sold to the TSO. But when this capacity is activated, the producer reduces its production and has to buy the corresponding balancing energy to the TSO. Even if the price is lower than the spot market price, it represents a charge. In order to be cost effective for the producer, the revenue of the downward capacity has to be higher than the charge of the balancing energy. In the third case, the producer sells in addition upward capacity to the TSO. In that case, he has to voluntarily decrease its production to guarantee upward balancing capacity. This reduces the revenues that come from the energy sold to the supplier. But when this upward capacity is activated, the producer increases his revenues by selling this energy to the TSO at a price that is in general higher than the day-ahead market price. In order to be cost effective for the producer, the revenues obtained from the sale of the upward balancing energy and from the sale of the upward balancing capacity has to be higher than the loss of revenues due to the decrease of the energy production to guarantee upward balancing capacity. So, in order to conclude, we have shown that the revenues of producers depend, among others, on the price of capacity, of energy, of balancing capacities, of balancing energy, and of the sale of guarantees of origin. I think that the potential of revenues on capacity market are rather low for solar plants because the peak load is not in phase with solar production. The revenues of solar energy on market depend nowadays of the market price augmented with the capacity revenue and with a public support called complement of remuneration. In that context, downward regulation activated by the energy supplier can be cost effective, for example, in case of negative prices on spot markets. In order to reduce their energy imbalance, the BRPs need reliable production forecast. Concerning the balancing market, as explained in previous slides, the downward reserve could be cost effective if downward balancing capacities incomes are greater than balancing energy charges. I think that the upward reserve is a priori not interesting because the voluntary decrease of production to deliver upward balancing capacity is very costly. And also, in order to reduce the balancing energy imbalance and to maximize the revenues of balancing capacities, the BSPs need reliable production forecasts. Concerning perspectives, I think it's very difficult and even impossible to forecast the energy producer's revenue in the long term. But the relative value of the balancing energy compared to the value of the energy could increase with the increase of renewables in the production mix. The revenues on capacity market could also increase if the peak load becomes in phase with the solar production, which could appear, for example, with the increase of air conditioning consumption or because of big changes in power consumption habits. And concerning energy markets, in the near future, the public support will certainly disappear. Concerning balancing market, I think that new products with a full activation time of approximately 1 or 2 seconds, a so-called synthetic inertia, will appear in the future with the reduction of rotating machine connected to the network, as Alberto has explained, and solar plant with their very fast power electronics inverters could provide the network with such a new product. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much.